you, I believe, came from Europe to Silicon Valley in around 2014, where you pretty quickly met some, I think, fairly influential people, probably some wealthy people. And this, as I understand it, kind of gave you the social context for creating what is now a successful research consultancy called Bismarck Analysis. And I, if it's okay with you, I kind of want to start here to give people a sense of, you know, your story and immediately start unpacking, you know, how were you able to do this, right? So first of all, the first question that comes to my mind is, you told me at one point that, you know, it's not too hard to meet powerful people. The hard part is having something to say to them. I found that a very interesting comment, and I think I know exactly what you mean, but I'm curious in your case, tell us, when you first went to Silicon Valley, what did you have to say to people?
Well, first off, I wanted to talk about them. I wanted to talk about their life, their success, and also what they had seen in the world. I was very interested in Western elites. That was kind of the stage of my research project. And you know, you're never going to find a good anthropology paper on Western elites. So your only real option, your only real recourse is to go talk to them, right? Over the years, I ended up going to places like Davos, etc. But Silicon Valley was my first beachhead, right? It seemed to me, obviously, I should talk to them. And everyone likes to be flattered. And interest is the most sincere type of flattery, honestly. It really is. So showing up with some empathy for the powerful is also quite unusual. Now, in addition to this, what I did think at the time and what I already brought, turned out I correctly thought at the time, was a little bit of a broader perspective, right? I ended up having very interesting conversations on history, which I wouldn't have predicted. But just very, very quickly through the course of a conversation from discussing like contemporary elites, contemporary politics, contemporary technology, people would ask me, Sama, well, why is this surprising? And then I'd have to answer with a concrete example of a society that just did things very, very differently. Sometimes the very recent past as well. You know, I would sit there and I would interrogate the concept of, you know, creative destruction. And I would ask them, you know, maybe the fact that we have to do so much disrupting is itself a sign that we live in a relatively like rigid, stagnant society, because you have to turn everything on its head in order to get anything done at all. Like, you really shouldn't need to be in a multi-front PR, legal, human resources war just to release, you know, just to release a new social media app. It really shouldn't be that hard. It somehow it is.
I see. Okay. So there's a few things you said there that I think are worth pausing on. One interesting comment you kind of snuck in there very, very quickly was your assertion that there's no good research literature on Western elites. That's a fascinating idea. Why do you think that is?
Well, I think at least contemporary Western elites, right? And I would argue, of course, there's always an inherent bias in anything that gets published is either written by someone that doesn't know what they're talking about or written by someone that's writing, you know, a hagiography of some kind, someone that's flattering, that's, you know, complicit in whatever PR goals exist. You know, if you imagine someone going to, say, you know, the statesman of the Western world today, and being like, hi, I'm an anthropologist from Yale. I've come to study how modern politics does decision making. Can I just sit into some of your meetings? I mean, at best, they're going to treat you as a clueless idiot. At worst, they're going to treat you as a spy or a journalist or someone who's going to get them in trouble. There's just no way you can even establish that initial trust to actually just see what's happening, to see what their real problems are, to see what problems they're trying to solve in their local politics that are often behind these decisions of immense organizations and trillions of dollars.
Okay, that's fascinating. So something I'm kind of hearing from you is that when it comes to elites, influential people, wealthy people, I think a lot of people out there have a mental model where they imagine these elites to be, you know, they imagine them as very admired, very in demand, very, you know, too busy to talk with people. But kind of what you're suggesting is that, in fact, Western elites feel generally misunderstood, neglected, loathed to some degree, and encountering someone who's thoughtful and intelligent and working on serious high-level intellectual problems, who has some kind of realistic understanding of the actual situation that Western elites are in, you're basically saying that that is immediately quite interesting to Western elites. And if you have something like that, or you're working on anything that really resonates on an authentic level with these people who often feel generally neglected in a sense by the culture, they're quite favorable to learning from you, or at least meeting with you and hearing a little bit more about whatever it is you're up to. Am I hearing that correct?
Yep, that's completely correct. And in a way, it shouldn't be too surprising, right? I think in a way we, you know, not to let them off the hook, they certainly are in fact complicit in a lot of the problems of our era. But by default, I think we blame them for all the problems of our era, right? Like, I feel like the relationship between, say, like, you know, something like a ruling class and something like the citizen is always fraught. There's always a question of, well, who fears who more? And current political philosophies in the West, like, they constantly suggest that, you know, if someone is sufficiently above you, they're kind of your enemy. You're supposed to be suspicious of them. You're supposed to be critical of them. You're supposed to be competitive with them, et cetera, et cetera. Now, to flip this on the other side, while we have this mythology, within their own organizations, everyone is a yes man. Everyone wants to get on their good side. So actually, you have to come in and show both empathy and critique of their position, but it has to be an informed critique. You can't use the normal Western elite critiques. If you come to them with new elite critiques that they've never heard before, that grabs their attention. It really does. It doesn't necessarily mean they immediately like you, but it does mean they'll, like, you know, stand around, you know, have a conversation with you, invite you for lunch, invite you for something, you know.
Right.